Penguin Random House Audio presents The Hope of Glory, Reflections on the Last Words of Jesus from the Cross. This is the author, Jon Meacham. In Memoriam, John Sharp Strang, 1918 to 2003, and Herbert Stevenson Wentz, 1934 to 2015. And as always, to Mary, Maggie, and Sam. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. The first epistle of Paul to the Corinthians. It is far better to accept teachings with reason and wisdom than with mere faith. Origen of Alexandria. Prologue. In the beginning. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. The first epistle of Paul to the Corinthians. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Jesus of Nazareth, the Gospel of John. It was only a brief moment, a small, seemingly throwaway remark in the midst of the most significant interview in history. In the Gospel of John, Jesus of Nazareth has been arrested and brought before Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor of Judea. "So you are a king?" Pilate asks. And Jesus says, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice." Then, in what I imagine to be a cynical, world-weary tone, Pilate replies, "What is truth?" What, indeed? Jesus says nothing in response, and Pilate's question is left hanging, an open query in the middle of John's rendering of the Passion. The search for an answer unfolds even now. For the hunger for truth, about the visible and the invisible, the seen and the unseen, the hoped for and the feared, is among the most fundamental of appetites. And that perennial quest for reply to Pilate tends to take religious form. "All men need the gods," Homer wrote, "and nothing since antiquity. Not the scientific revolution, not the Enlightenment, not Darwin, not anything has altered the impulse of human beings to organize stories and create systems of belief that draw on the past, give shape to the present, and promise a future of justice, mercy, and peace." Gods, the Protestant theologian Paul Tillich wrote in the middle of the 20th century, are beings who transcend the realm of ordinary experience and power and meaning, with whom men have relations which surpass ordinary relations in intensity and significance. For Christians, the central truth of existence is captured in the death and resurrection of Jesus. Without Good Friday, there is no Easter. Without Easter, there is no deliverance from evil. Without deliverance from evil, there is no victory of light over dark, of love over hate, of life over death. Yet that victory is the radical, revolutionary, and essential promise of Christianity, a promise revealed to us in the Passion of Jesus. The work of discerning, or depending on your point of view, assigning meaning to Good Friday and to the story of the empty tomb is a historical as well as a theological process, as was the construction of the faith that has shaped and is shaping the lives of billions of believers. I am one among that innumerable company, and this book is a series of reflections on the last words of Jesus from the cross, words spoken on a Friday afternoon that is at once impossibly remote and yet imaginatively close to hand. It is a devotional work, not a scholarly one. I am an Episcopalian who was raised and educated in the faith, and I would be disheartened if my own young children were to turn away from the church in which they have grown up. I am, however, in no sense an evangelical, for I do not share the view that faith in Jesus is the only route to salvation, nor am I determined to convert others to my point of view. Thomas Jefferson once remarked, "It does me no injury for my neighbor to say there are 20 gods or no God. It neither picks my pocket nor breaks my leg." In a sermon, John Leland, a leading Baptist preacher in Virginia and Massachusetts in the 18th and early 19th centuries, once observed, "Experience teaches us that men who are equally wise and good may differ in political as well as in theological or mathematical opinions." Some 1,400 years earlier, in the 4th century, a Roman writer, arguing against Christians who wanted to remove an altar to the pagan deity Victory, said, "We cannot attain to so great a mystery by one way." I agree. So what do I believe? I adhere to the broad outlines of the Christian faith as it has come down through the Anglican tradition. I profess the creeds. I confess my many sins. I make my communion. I say my prayers. And I believe that in so doing, I am taking part in a drama whose ultimate purposes I cannot yet and may never fully grasp, but in which I invest my hopes that someday, in some way, all things will be made new. An important note. Though this book began as a series of sermons, which are, by definition, discourses on religious subjects, it is about illumination, not conversion. I am sharing these meditations in the hope that a sense of history and an appreciation of theology might help readers make more sense of the cross in a world too much given to the competing forces of hostile skepticism, blind acceptance, or remote indifference. In the Hebrew Bible, in the midst of great suffering, Job proclaims a great faith. "I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth." If Job could know, then at least we can hope. At the heart of my own hope is the belief that the God of Abraham, whom I also believe is God the Father of the Holy Trinity, is the architect of a creation that has fallen into corruption and disorder. The redemption of that creation has been set in motion by the passion, crucifixion, and resurrection of a preacher and wonder worker in first century Judea. In the tradition I inherited, that preacher was a great moral teacher. His Sermon on the Mount and his frequently repeated messages, rooted in the scriptures of Israel, about the centrality of love, can hardly be improved upon as guides to goodness and generosity. He does not, however, endure because he offered a corner of the Roman-dominated world a message of radical love. He endures not only because of what he said, but because of who he was. In the words of Peter, "The Christ, the Son of the living God." Christianity's foundational belief is that Jesus was in fact the Christ, in Greek, the Anointed One, who died and rose again to redeem and restore a fallen world that is to be reborn as what John the Divine called a new heaven and a new earth. That is what Peter's confession means, and it is what Christians mean when they proclaim Jesus Lord and predict his coming again, even if they are not particularly clear on the details of what that entails. Whether one believes or disbelieves, or dwells, as so many of us do, somewhere in between, tacking now toward one pole and then toward another, and back again and again and again, attention must be paid. Albert Schweitzer wrote in his landmark, The Quest of the Historical Jesus, "Jesus means something to our world because a mighty spiritual force streams forth from him and flows through our time also. This fact can neither be shaken nor confirmed by any historical discovery. It is the solid foundation of Christianity. The English novelist and biographer A.N. Wilson put the matter this way. The strange fact is that the figure of Jesus remains, even in a world where institutional Christianity would appear to be on its last legs, and where religious belief itself, in the West at least, would appear to be rapidly on the decline. Jesus is a shadowy figure historically.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.